Why, if the constitution can provide for Hindus, why it doesn't provide for them? It does provide for them. But there's no government to date which has had the nerve to pass such a law. We have this Waqf Act, but that literally, gives a power to the Muslim community itself. Whereas this HRNC gives the power to the bureaucracy. And in the case of the Waqf Act, it goes to. So when I once jokingly said in the court that only Hindus are being targeted, well, what about mosque or a madrasa? So the judges took it seriously, said, bring us one case of mismanagement of finances by a mosque or a madrasa, and we will appoint somebody from the government to look into their finances, as we are doing with the Hindu government. I could not find a single madrasa. Nobody is daring to give me any detail, because I don't think they have account books at all. Everything is done on cash. It comes from Saudi Arabia by cash, and then it is distributed as cash. So I there's no reason for you to say this is unfair. We have used these laws in these unfair ways. So I think, therefore, it's only a matter of time. But please think. Use your brains, hold seminars, whatever. Tell me, once the temple is freed, who will look after it? Number one. And number two, how to ensure that the alleged malpractices don't occur again? How is there an oversight? Would you like the CAG to be there doing that? Whether you want to, then you'll have to amend the CAG Act for it. So some concrete suggestions from all of you as to the post-HRNC Act quashing, how do you make the temples viable again? And temples cannot be viable only on hundi. It has to have its land restored. You know, in Tamil Nadu, in the city of Madras, land which is in large numbers, I think 3,000 acres of land, is being given out in rent for 1 rupee to commercial enterprises. 1 rupee per acre is the rent that they are charging. And this is a conspiracy of the government with these industrialists. And these industrialists are building establishments on it. So if you restore the land, if they are allowed to grow crops, if you restore schools, colleges, etc., with the temple, they'll all become self-sufficient. The idea is how to make it self-sufficient. This is the second thing I would like all of you to apply your mind, or at least commission somebody who can apply his mind, and then work out, or create an endowment by which somebody can apply to you that I will work on this project and you finance it. This is the way we can revive it. Now, the last question that remains is the Ram Temple issue. Is Ram Temple going to be built by the BJP government? Question. Everybody asked me. Well, it's there in the manifesto. And I'm not going to allow my government not to build it. So I'll force it. Many things I've done by forcing the government. They don't like it, but they have been forced. Raghuram Rajan, nobody thought would be brought it off. So, we are not a pyramid party. One leader and everybody else is submissive, like Congress party. Ours is like a Himalayan peak, lots of peaks are there. There's RSS there, there's Vishwanthu Parishad there, there's Vidyarthi Parishad there, and there are rebels like myself there. All that, therefore the party functions more or less democratically. It's not possible for the party to lay saying, no temple will be built. I say, yes, temple will be built. So somewhere a work is worked out. Now, it has been decided to build a temple. All right, now question is when? Well, we have also said in our manifesto that it will be done by legal means, which is the Supreme Court. The matter is in the Supreme Court. We won the case in the Allahabad High Court. The Waqf Board came in appeal to the Supreme Court. Now, Waqf Board's appeal is what? Not that, oh, these Hindu mobs demolished our masjid, we want our masjid back. That's not their argument. It cannot be their argument. It will be un-Islamic to give that argument. Their argument is that we have adverse possession of the Ram Janmabhoomi. We occupied it 300 years ago and nobody challenged us all this time. Now, therefore, it is our property. Yes, it's true in our law, if you have a house and I occupy it forcibly and you don't do anything for 12 years, then it becomes my house by a concept called adverse possession. So, therefore, they have been there 300 years. So, but they can't say they have been 300 years and the Hindus didn't challenge. Every year during the 18th century, 17th century, 16th century, the Hindus rioted, they were killed, the Muslims killed them first, then the British killed them because of to control the rioting. So the Hindus never gave up. And the first thing that happened after independence is that somehow mysteriously, that's what they say, but I know what really happened. At least the FIR says something different, that some people entered in the night the Babri Masjid and put the murtis of Lord Rama and Sita and Krishna and Lakshmana. And after that, prayer started. Then the government put a lock and key on it. And then Rajiv Gandhi came. He ordered that the lock should be removed. I must tell you one thing. I was a great friend of Rajiv Gandhi. And I will say that if he had remained Prime Minister, he would definitely have built the Ram Temple. That was an assurance he gave many of us. And he not only opened the lock of the Babri Masjid, which enabled Hindus to go inside, but he also allowed the Vishnu Parishad to do the Shilanyas program. And on television, he allowed Ramayana should be shown as a serial, which created a huge impact. I don't know whether you people remember it or not. People didn't even go to watch cricket matches on Sunday because Ramayana was coming. So, unfortunately, he was killed by the LTTE. At whose behest, that we have to find out in the future. But the fact of the matter is that he was, towards the end of his life, I found him as a person who was very well motivated to reviving these Hindu concepts. I don't know what happened to him. Maybe he met a nice girl or something like that. I don't know what the reason is. There was some reason that that transformation took place, but it was a very pleasant transformation. Narasimha Rao, he was past master. I mean, Narasimha Rao was the exact opposite of Rajiv Gandhi. Rajiv Gandhi, everything was open, and he used to get into trouble on that. Narasimha Rao used to go like the river, you know. He would erode the rock, but it would be over a period of time. Now, what he did is when the Babri Masjid was demolished, he gave a written statement in the Supreme Court through the Solicitor General of India that if there it can be shown that there was an existing, pre-existing temple before the masjid, then this land would be handed over to the Hindus. It's a commitment of the government. It's binding on our government also. So, was it proved? Yes, it was proved. Because Supreme Court immediately referred it to the Allahabad High Court and said, find out whether there was a pre-existing temple. So, the Supreme Court asked the Archaeological Survey of India. The Archaeological Survey of India appointed a Hindu and a Muslim, two people to investigate. They used all modern techniques. And unanimous report was that below the Babri Masjid, there exists a huge Hindu temple, a Vaishnav temple. This is the report. So this report became very useful for us. Now we say, well, this is a government commitment, so let the government honor it by handing over the property. Now, why is it that for Muslims, this is not an important issue? Because masjid is not like a temple. A temple is built by prana pratishtha puja, so Lord enters and he becomes the owner. This principle has been accepted by the Allahabad High Court. High Court Allahabad said that this belongs to Ram Lala, because the faith is that he was born there and that Prana Pratishtha Puja was indeed performed before the temple was built. So we will give this area to the Hindus, but we think that in the larger interests of Hindu-Muslim unity, of the three domes, one may be given to the Muslims to build a mosque. Now, how can you build a mosque next to a temple? So, you know, it's unnecessarily provocation. Militants will use it and all kinds of things can happen. So, I have my proposal to the Muslims is that you go across Saryu River, the river that flows there, and there's plenty of land there, and we will help you build a masjid there. After all, masjid is only a prayer hall. Who says that? All the scholars of Saudi Arabia say masjid is nothing more than a prayer hall, a place of convenience for people to collect and read namaz. You can even do namaz in an airport. I think in America you have small kiosks for reading namaz.
They moved it, they made it to yoga.
Okay. Indication of the future, is it? Anyway, the fact is that namaz can be read anywhere. It can be read here, it can be read on the road, and in fact in big occasions in India, roads are blocked and Muslims assemble on it and do namaz. It can be read in a railway platform, it can be read on an aeroplane. Namaz is a place, can be read anywhere. This is what the Saudi Arabians say, and they practice it too. Because Saudi Arabia has demolished more mosques than any other country of the world. And why? Because they want to build an apartment building, they want to build a road. Turkey Prime Minister said, for me, it is more Islamic to build national highway than masjids. So if a masjid stands in the way, it will go. Turkey has gone on record. All these you will get in Google. Then one day the Saudi Arabian government decided that they wanted to build a palace in Makkah. For themselves. So they found that the only place available is there is a ground in which the masjid where Muhammad used to read his namaz. So Bilal Masjid it is called. That masjid they decided to abolish. Then UNESCO wrote them a letter that at least this masjid you can spare because Muhammad read it. It is a relic, it's an ancient heritage, this and that. So Saudi Arabia replied, don't give us lectures on this. You are giving us, you're trying to teach us to adopt Murti Puja, that is idol worship. There is no such thing as Muhammad read in a particular masjid, therefore it has become sacred. That is against Islam. And we will all the more reason resolve to break this because we don't want this idol worship concept to come. So they destroyed that also. And so I asked the Saudi Arabians, I have many friends because at Harvard, many of them are my students. Finance minister of Saudi Arabia came to India for a place. He invited me for dinner. I asked him, is this true that you can demolish a masjid? He said, yes. So I said, in India, if we say, no, Babri Masjid cannot be there. It can go somewhere else. Is it okay? He said, yes, it's according to Islamic law, it's okay. I said, will you give it to me in writing? He said, well, first you must, with affection, tell the Muslims that please take your masjid across the river. That I've already done and told them. And the Muslim community in India has told me that if you get the order from the Supreme Court, not out of court settlement, from the Supreme Court, that the mandir should be built, we will agree. So I said, what's your difficulty in having out of court settlement if you are agreed? He said, then people say that you have taken money from Swami and that's why you have done a somersault. So, therefore it's better for us to do it. I said, therefore the only solution is we go to court, tell the Supreme Court, please constitute a bench and that bench should hear this matter on a day-to-day basis. Within 1 month we will get a decision that this area belongs to Lord Rama and therefore a mandir should be built. And everything about the Ram temple, thanks to the Vishnu Parishad, is already prefabricated and lying to be. You think, I will believe that in 3 months, we'll be able to build the entire Ram temple once we get the order. So it is coming. Now, there are some technical issues. The Supreme Court has to appoint a bench to hear this matter. On a day-to-day basis, the government of India should come and support me. I'm also a party. I was being made by the Supreme Court as a party because I know so much about the subject. And therefore, if I raise it, the other Muslim parties won't agree. I mean, they will not agree means they will not oppose it, but they will just keep quiet, which is what happened last time. And didn't succeed. Now, if the government of India comes with this through its Solicitor General or any law officer and says, yes, we are in favor of a day-to-day hearing, the court will agree. That is exactly what Manmohan Singh government did in Ayodhya's matter in the Allahabad High Court. They said we prefer a day-to-day hearing, this matter should be brought to an end, and the Allahabad court agreed. Manmohan Singh has done two good things in his life as Prime Minister. One is he did not resign. Had he resigned, then Rahul Gandhi would have become Prime Minister, and that's the end of it. And two was this, that he also did a third good thing, but I will not mention it, or maybe I'll mention it. He sanctioned Rajapaksa finishing off Prabhakaran, which required him to have guts, because there are a lot of supporters of Prabhakaran in the Congress party. But he was asked this question, we have surrounded him, we want to finish him, do you agree? And he said, yes, you can finish him because he's a war criminal. And that is the third thing he did. Otherwise, poor chap, you know, he's built that way. He's like a circus lion. He obeys a ringmaster, and this ringmaster happened to be an Italian lady. Italians are now figuring everywhere. The other day I was doing some archival, I went to the National Archives to look at the Gandhi's assassination papers in view of what Rahul Gandhi has said. I found that Godse had used an Italian pistol. So I'm investing in that. So maybe in the cross-examination of Rahul Gandhi in the defamation case, we'll ask him, do you know it's an Italian pistol? And is it yours or something like that? So the issue is this, that there is nothing to stop legally Ram Temple from being constructed. The question of time, I expect that the bench which is to be constituted will be possible. In my opinion, should include one Muslim judge, definitely. Maybe can include one Sikh judge and one Hindu judge. So that people feel that, you know, all points of view were heard by the judges, and it was not, no scurrilous allegations of communalism be made against any judges. In Allahabad also we had a Muslim judge. At the moment we don't have a single Muslim judge in the Supreme Court. So we'll have to find one. And I'm sure that by the end of this month it'll be done. After Diwali, November 1st week, I hope to hear that the government has decided to come and say that yes, we support a hearing, the bench will be constituted, and probably get the judgment around February, and which means that by end of 2017 or early 2018, the Ram Temple will be open for darshan for all of you. The only thing I say to you in the end is, you see, today we have everything to become a great economic power. Maybe we are struggling here and there for some other reasons. One of the reasons was Mr. Raghuram Rajan raised the interest rate so high that all our small and medium industries collapsed. That means employment also for semi-skilled could not be done. He argued that, well, you see, to control inflation, I need to raise interest rates. Now, because he's not an economist, he was an IIT graduate and then became a management expert. So I don't think he understands that economics is a general equilibrium system. An economy is a general equilibrium system. Something you do here, it affects everywhere. In the depression in America in the 1920s, there was unemployment rising in America. So the economists of that period suggested that one of the ways to to increase employment, is to lower the wage rate. If you reduce the wage rate, or allow companies to reduce the wage rate, then more employment takes place. Now, that on superficially sounds very reasonable. But in a general equilibrium setup of the economy, that is disastrous. Because what happened is you reduced the wage rates, as these economists wanted, and therefore purchasing power also decreased. Therefore, demand also decreased. And therefore, companies started making losses. And therefore, there was more unemployment. This is what happened. Same way, you raise interest rates, then these companies which are small and medium, which are all domestic companies, they don't have any foreign connections or access to foreign funds, their cost of capital goes up. They can't manage, so they start defaulting on bank payments, and finally they close down. Large numbers of business close down. So I had told them, you see, there are doctors who have said that if you find a temperature of a patient going on rising, then the best way to control the temperature is to kill him. Then temperature will definitely come down. So that's one way of controlling temperature. But is that the way you want? So in our country, these small policy problems have been responsible for us not shooting up. We've got tremendous potential. And it's only a matter of time. I had argued that in the 70s and 80s, that if you give up socialism, growth rate will go up. And all the communists got after me and hurled abuses at me. In the end, I came to office in Chandrasekhar's government, later on held a minister's rank position in Narasimha Rao's government. We did exactly that, gave up.